And good morning.
Good morning.
I am Scot Giles, the affiliated community minister to Countryside Church. My pronouns are he, his, and I would never make a joke about being bald. Well, I mean, it isn't fair. I mean, all men have about the same amount of hormones, and if some guy chooses to use theirs to grow hair, that's up to them. Today is the day we have looked for. All our life has been spent in preparation for it. Yesterday and tomorrow are faraway nothings, one a faint memory, the other a vague promise. But this is our day. It offers all that life has to give, the wise resolve to make the most of it. So let us make the most of it. For my chalice lighting, these words by Howard Thurman. Open unto us light for our darkness. Open unto us courage for our fear. Open unto us hope for any despair. Open unto us peace and hope for our hearts. And now rise as you are able and join in singing hymn number 38, Morning Has Broken. Reciting our covenant, we unite to strengthen the bonds of kinship among all persons, to promote human dignity, and to increase reverence for life's creating, sustaining, and transforming power through worship, study, and service. Please be seated.
Good morning. Again, I'm Marta Cachene. I am the Religious Exploration Manager here at Countryside. If you're a visitor, that means I work with our kids. And I'd like to call the young and young at heart to come down at this time for a message for all ages. Good morning. Good morning. It's good to see you all. Today's story is called The Magic of Me by My Magical Choices, written by Becky Cummings. Come on down, Jesse. And illustrated by Susanna Svobodvova. The choices you make have superpowers. They bring sunshine or rainy showers. So here are some magical things to do that bring the sun to shine right through. Listen closely to this life advice. Say, I choose, and end with something nice. Take some action. Choose what to do. Repeat this often because magic lives in you. I choose to be responsible. Bathing, brushing, getting dressed. Now you look and feel your best. You clean up all the mess you make. Helping out gives mom or dad a break. I choose to be helpful. Putting toys away and feed the cat. You might just like a job like that. Just raise your hand or jump right in. When helping others, we all win. I choose to be patient. Take your time and wait your turn. Those are tricky things to learn. When life is slow, you've got to wait. Stay calm and know it turns out great. I choose to be confident. You know you can. You believe in you. All by yourself, you try something new. You don't give up when things get rough. You know you're made to be super tough. I choose to be generous. Giving gifts for no reason at all. A cupcake, a flower, maybe a ball. Donating books, clothes, or a toy fills your heart with bursts of joy. I choose to be calm. When you're upset, count to 10, or take a break, then try again. If you still feel you're sad and blue, take a calming breath or two. I choose to be brave. You speak what's important, kind and true. Your heart leads the way and knows what to do. You try new things with a good attitude. You do it politely without being rude. I choose to be forgiving. If something makes you feel so sad, use words to explain the hurt you had. Then it's okay to let these feelings go. Heal your heart and let your smile show. You are the captain of your own ship. You steer the wheel on this magic trip. So wisely choose the things you do. And always remember, magic starts in you. Special as can be, this is the magic of me. And now we'll sing our kids back to their seats.
And now I invite you to join your hearts and minds together in the spirit of meditation and reflective prayer. Spirit of life, breath of life, source of our being, from the peacefulness of our silence, may your speaking enter the world by filling our hearts and minds with gratitude. Today, as we remember lost friends and loved ones, we boldly approach you with our prayers for peace. We are mindful of our shortcomings. We have not always been people of peace and reconciliation, but we hope to be. Grant us humility and honesty in this moment as we collect our thoughts. May we reflect on our broken relationships with family, friends, acquaintances, even strangers. We admit we sometimes harbor a hard heart, broken by blame and inappropriate guilt. Soften our hearts, that we might become instruments of reconciliation and healing, that peace might be restored. We pray for peace in our world and peace amongst nations that seem to thrive on warring madness. We pray for peace in conflicted countries around the world. Bear with us as we wrap our minds around such support and love which may surround us, and we would will that such love come to surround nations no matter what conflicts arise. Strengthen our resolve to place our trust in the basic goodness of people and creation. Give us a passion to work for health, sustainability, and justice for all people. We also pray for peace in ourselves. Peace in the face of the challenges of life. May we find serenity in the face of any trouble, aging, conflicted love, or illness. Grant us peace. Amen.
I'm Allison Vernon, your director of music, she, her. And this month we have been celebrating pluralism. And according to the dictionary, a condition or system in which two or more states, groups, principles, sources of authority, theologies, and ideas can coexist. And that's really who we try to be in UU, I think. And so today we're going to try to express that musically. And the person I think who does that the best is Johann Sebastian Bach. He takes in his 2- and 3-part inventions and fugues, each line could be a solo if we wanted it to be. But instead, he puts it all together into one piece.
Oh,
fine musical program. My reading is a short one. It's a poem by Robert Frost, Fire and Ice, from his book New Hampshire, published in 1923. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if it had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction ice is also great and would suffice. On Easter, I did a sermon to this congregation regarding the view taken by liberal Bible scholars about the supposed resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. Afterwards, someone asked if I would speak about the prediction of the apocalypse in the Bible. They said they hear a lot about it from their more traditional friends and were curious about what I might make of the stories regarding the end of days. Nah, I said. If I did that, it would only scare people. And then I thought about that, and I said, oh boy. So apocalypse it is. In the 1980s, when I was serving as the parish minister to the Unitarian Universalist Church in Oak Park, Illinois, I had an experience that no Unitarian Universalist minister expects to have. I had a group of, and I'm not making this up, I had a group of church members who were seriously worried that the apocalypse they'd heard about from Scripture was about to happen and wanted to know what they should do to prepare. Now, when someone talks about an apocalypse, you first need to figure out what they mean. The word apocalypse comes from the Greek word for the uncovering of something hidden, or more simply, revelation. And Revelation is the title of the final book in the modern Bible, which supposedly tells about the end of history. But that's not what most people mean about the apocalypse these days. If you spend a few minutes with Google, you'll discover that there's a whole literature out there about what the world would be like after the apocalypse. But this post-apocalyptic literature, movies, and programming tends to be about an invasion of zombies, a nuclear war, environmental collapse, economic atrocity, nothing to do with the Bible at all. However, as I listened to my frightened parishioners, they were not worried about the end of the world due to limits of resources, overpopulation, nuclear war, or a proliferation of zombies. Instead, they were afraid that the Bible's predictions were coming true. Now, there are a lot of people who believe that the prophecies in the Bible about the end of days are real. Some of these people are in high places, and we ignore that reality to our peril. Many of you are old enough to remember the Secretary of the Interior during the Reagan administration, the person charged to oversee conservation. His name was James Watt, and at one point he actually dismissed the need for environmental conservation by saying, and this is a quote, "I do not know how many future generations we can count on before the Lord returns," unquote. There are other politicians in power who believe the same. In fact, I suspect there are more of them today than when Mr. Watt told us we didn't need to worry about climate change because Jesus was coming back. Imagining that there is a divine plan for the end of days, imagining that we might get special treatment, that people we don't like will get their comeuppance, has an attraction. It's an emotional get out of jail free card to excuse people from having to make the choices that could actually shape the world. People use it to avoid considering the warnings science gives us about objective problems like world hunger, injustice, and climate. That's a shame because we could choose to do something about those problems. But not if we convince ourselves that the seals will break, trumpets will sound, and everything will be made new without our having to lift a finger. And that is what a whole lot of people believe. I kid you not. Well, with regard to my parishioners, it turned out that there had been a program on Christian television that was a pseudo-documentary. Supposedly, scientists had fed news reports into a supercomputer that could also access any book ever written, and the computer came to the conclusion that world events were following the predictions of the book of Revelations in the Bible exactly, and therefore the end of the world was due soon. Well, after a bit of investigation, I learned that the company that produced this program for Christian television in Chicago used an advertising agency that employed a member of my congregation. He was a bit of a strange person, and for a Unitarian Universalist, that's saying a lot. He invited people over to watch it and, as a prank, told them that such a computer actually existed and that the conclusions in the show were believed to be correct by influential scientists. Now, I hope you heard what I just said. He did this as a prank. There was no supercomputer. Well, I got everyone calmed down, explaining the whole thing as a hoax, and sent them home to turn back into rational adults. But I began to ponder why biblical mythology about the end of the world holds such fascination for so many people. Now, the Bible is full of prophecies. There are four major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel, and 12 minor prophets. If you are like me, raised in a traditional Christian Sunday school, you probably were taught that these prophets were making predictions about crises and difficulties that would befall the Hebrew people, and which came to pass as a sign of God's wisdom predicting these problems. However, what liberal scholars believe today is that all of the prophecy in Scripture was actually retrospective. That is, the prophecies were written after, sometimes considerably after, the events they recount took place. They weren't predictions, they were explanations. We know this because modern archaeology allows us to carbon date ruins and artifacts that have survived. And the rapidly changing language styles of ancient tongues allow us to know approximately when a particular text was written. Well, something bad had happened and people were shocked and uncertain. The prophet would come along and minister to the spiritual needs of the people by coming up with a narrative to explain why the calamity occurred. This was comforting because it provided an explanation and also explained what might be done to prevent such problems in the future. Think back to when you learned about the fall of the World Trade Center on September 11th, 2001. Many of you probably were glued to your televisions, astonished and shaken, wondering how such a thing could happen. At first, you could hardly believe it. Such things were not supposed to happen in America. But then leaders, functioning much like ancient prophets, explained it to you. You learned about Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden. You learned about the temperature at which jet fuel burned and steel melted. You learned about the poor security at airports. Gradually, you assembled these into a narrative and you understood what had happened. And the Transportation Security Administration came into being, and we all got used to taking off our shoes at the airport. This provided a measure of comfort because we now felt we understood what had happened and what we could do to avoid such things. It worked. There's not been a hijacked aircraft since. Well, that's the service the biblical prophets provided to the people of their time as well. But the service was explanatory, not clairvoyant. The book of Revelation is the final book in the New Testament. We have no idea who the author was. The only thing he calls himself is John. Traditionally, people thought he was the Apostle John, who knew Jesus of Nazareth, but more recent scholarship casts doubt on that because of the style of writing. These days, he's typically referred to as John of Patmos, after the Greek island in the Aegean Sea where he said he was living. From the style of the writing, we can date the book to the reign of the Roman Emperor Domitian, who reigned between the years 81 and 96 Common Era. If you've ever tried to read the book of Revelation, you probably gave up. The book is a jumble of prophecy, symbols, metaphors, including a seven-headed dragon, the beast, the Antichrist, the serpent, and others. It is so confusing and vague that one can argue for almost any interpretation. That said, though, the book contains some of the most amazing religious imagery ever created. There shall come a new heaven and a new earth. The trumpet shall sound and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. Handel put that in Messiah, a piece of music often sung by our choir. The image of a new Jerusalem and much, much more. Scholars classify the book of Revelation as an example of the cosmic combat archetype, a primordial battle between order and chaos. This is an archetypal theme found in religious literature all over the globe. We see it in this book in the battle between Jehovah and someone called the Beast 666. But we also see it in the Mesopotamian battle between Marduk and the dragon Tiamat from 1000 before the Common Era. We see it in Luke Skywalker battling Emperor Palpatine in the Star Wars movie. This is an archetypal theme. But if you have Orthodox or mainstream friends and family, they probably believe the book of Revelation foretells the end of the world, the final victory of Jehovah, the return of Jesus of Nazareth, and the resurrection of the dead. Here is what they believe will happen. The tale begins with the time of signs and wonders, when things will happen which hint at the coming end of days. Events then are said to unfold with the breaking of seven seals. Think of wax seals on a proclamation. This is what got my former parishioner so upset. The fake computer was supposedly looking at things that were happening, wars, famines, plagues, which were all supposed to happen during the time of signs and wonders. Then the seals break. The breaking of the first seal will result in the rise of a white horse ridden by a man wearing a crown and holding a bow. This first horseman of the apocalypse is conquest. The breaking of the second seal will result in war. The symbol is a red horse made from fire with the rider holding a large sword. The breaking of the third seal results in famine. The symbol is a black horse whose rider holds a pair of scales, which you might do to weigh out food. The breaking of the fourth seal results in plague, symbolized by a pale horse ridden by death. There would be a massive die-off. The breaking of the fifth seal results in something called the tribulation. The world will become a dark place with crime, disorder, and lawlessness. Prior to this, 144,000 Orthodox Jews will be lifted off the earth, avoiding the tribulation as their reward. Also will come the rapture, when a vast number of faithful people will ascend from the earth into heaven and also avoid the tribulation. I should note that the rapture is an interpretation of a verse from the book of 1 Thessalonians in the New Testament. It is not specifically mentioned anywhere in the Bible, nor is that name used, regardless of what people might tell you. The breaking of the sixth seal ends the tribulation. There will be massive destruction, including meteorite impacts, followed by the breaking of the seventh seal, which results in an immense silence. Then there will come a series of trumpets. The first six are wake-up calls for sinners to repent. More woes come, each trumpet blast bringing with it some new calamity. The final trumpet allows the rise of three beasts. The first beast, a red dragon with seven heads, Satan himself. The second beast emerges from the sea and also has seven heads, and for some reason people worship it. Then there arises a third beast from the ground in the shape of a lamb, who announces how wonderful the second beast is. This is the Antichrist, and he brands his followers with a mark, the number 666. Then comes seven bowls poured out upon the earth, each bringing a new hardship. There will be a tremendous battle between the forces of the Antichrist and the forces of Jehovah, and it will take place on a mound in northern Israel called Megiddo, and the battle will be called Armageddon. The sun will turn black, the moon will turn red, the stars will fall to earth, the sky itself will be rolled up, and every mountain and island laid low. Jesus himself will return. After a thousand-year gap, time ends and a new world begins, with all people living with God in a new Jerusalem. That's the Orthodox interpretation. Now, let me be transparent here. I do not expect anything in the book of Revelation to happen, because I believe it already has. I am one of the Bible scholars who believe that the events recounted in the book of Revelation were retrospective, just like every other prophecy in the Bible. It was written to explain the persecution experienced by the Christian community in the first century under Emperor Domitian and his predecessors. The Jesus people didn't know what to think. Jesus had supposedly triumphed over death and everything was supposed to be better. But obviously it was not. Everywhere they looked, they were persecuted. The Emperor Domitian was on the throne in Rome, but his predecessor, Nero, persecuted the followers of Jesus without mercy. That was not supposed to happen. The apostles of Jesus had predicted a time of goodwill and peace to come in the wake of Jesus. Instead, Rome became yet another example of dominator culture. There was political oppression. There was economic oppression. There was theological oppression. All good things in the world were being gathered into Rome and distributed to a privileged aristocratic 1%. That was not supposed to happen. just like in our time, the fall of the World Trade Center was not supposed to happen. Like prophets everywhere, John wrote to provide a retrospective explanation. His purpose was to offer hope. To scholars such as myself, the Antichrist is none other than Nero. In ancient alphabets, letters were often used as numbers. Think of Roman numerals. And if you work out the number for the emperor Nero, it is 666. The same number as the book of Revelation gives to the Antichrist. The seven-headed dragon and the later seven-headed beast, the imperial city of Rome itself with its famous seven hills. John was prophesying, proposing Rome's downfall and what he hoped would be the eventual triumph of the followers of Jesus. He was trying to symbolically explain why things had gone wrong and that the future would be better. He was mistaken. Rome would continue its oppression for another 300 years. Jesus did not return. Things did get better, but not for a very long time. But people would cling to the hope of a better tomorrow, and I think we can understand that desire with empathy. So there you have my view. The book of Revelation is not a prediction. Like prophecy throughout the Bible, it was a retrospective explanation for what had happened and offered an interpretation that could give hope for the future, and that is no small thing. Now, if you are to share my opinion with your more orthodox believer friends, they would dismiss it. They would point to things happening around the world now, which they would claim were predicted to happen during the time of signs and wonders. War, rumors of war, plague, famine. But there is a trick the brain plays on us. I've said it to you before, your brain evolved to keep you safe, not to make you happy. One of the ways it keeps you safe is encouraging you to overlook the past in favor of focusing on any possible danger in the future. Years ago, in the cancer care movement where much of my career has been conducted, there was a popular theory that most people who got cancer had experienced some major loss within 2 years of diagnosis. There were actually books written proposing that cancer was actually a profound grief response. However, social scientists realized that just about everyone has experienced some major loss within any given two-year time slice. Loss is part of life. So yeah, cancer patients reported such losses, but so did people who did not develop cancer. And that's the problem with all the popular predictions of an imminent apocalypse. There have always been wars and rumors of wars. There has always been sickness. There has always been famine. There have always been authoritarian leaders. These things are not unique to our time. So there really isn't anything to the belief of the end of days, according to me. But we get hooked. A year doesn't go by when I do not encounter some religious movement or preacher announcing the apocalypse is coming and we need to get right with God by giving them money. There have literally been hundreds of end time declarations, Christian and otherwise. Remember the harmonic convergence? How on December 12, 2012, the Mayan calendar was supposed to run out of dates, and for some reason that was important. There were people everywhere predicting the equators would realign, the poles would switch, a rogue planet would crash into the Earth, or a massive solar flare would happen. Remember? I was a parish minister at the time. And there were people who showed up at the church that morning to wave crystals, burn stage, and pray. Nothing happened. Ever hear about the Millerites, the followers of William Miller, who declared the apocalypse would happen in 1843? It didn't, whereupon they proclaimed the Great Disappointment. I'm not kidding, that's what they call it to this day. And founded the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Something similar happened to the Church of Jehovah's Witness. Even Billy Graham thought end times were close. You don't have to look hard to find these folks. You probably have them in your own family. Well, on this Memorial Day, when we remember those we've loved and lost, especially those who died in service to making this world better, choosing to risk their lives, let's all resolve to take care of the world they and others protected. And let us honor old John of Patmos, mistaken though he was. He was upset about oppression in the world of his time, and we should be upset about it in our time too. However, we should try to do something about it. Not wait passively for the trumpets to sound or someone else to solve our problems. Remember that, especially in times like these. And that's my sermon. And now freely we have received of gifts that minister to our needs of body and spirit. Gladly we bring to our church and its wide concerns a portion of this bounty as the morning offering is received.
What happens if a musician prefers, rock music, maybe like a percussionist might? But what happens if, in this case, a trombonist prefers jazz-style music? And what happens if the pianist prefers classical music, and yet we all want to go to the same church?
Thank you.
And now please remain standing and repeat responsively with me the words of our benediction. And now may the truth that makes us free,
and now may the truth that makes us free,
and the hope that never dies,
and the hope that never dies,
and the love that casts out fear,
and the love that casts out fear,
lead us forward together.
Lead us forward together.
Until the day spring breaks.
Until the day spring breaks.
And the shadows flee away.
And the shadows flee away.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Hello, Anne.